there.
Everybody, and welcome to NHL Tonight. Here we go. Tony, JD, I'm Jameson. Let's get right to the action. This series now shifting to Boston. Game three, Bruins and Panthers. Both teams looking to take a 2-1 series lead after tempers got hot in game number two. Sam Bennett returning to the lineup for the Panthers. This guy hasn't played since game two of round number one due to a hand injury. Andrew Ferentz, 2011 Stanley Cup champion, your banner waiver for game number three. Here we go. 3.5 minutes into period number one. Collision here. Sam Bennett and Brad Marchand at center ice. Marchand, slow to get up here.
Yeah, a guy like this, just a warrior. Looks like shoulder back. Can't speculate, but not a good look to start the game for him.
All right, more physicality. There's David Pastrnak. Gets laid out by Bennett. Bennett making an impact early.
You know, and Bennett, there's a guy that has missed the five games, but he comes back into the game and has an impact from his first shift in the game. You put two big centers, Barkov and him, 1-2, and you got some big players down the middle of the ice.
Well, not the prettiest of goals, but they'll certainly take it. Evan Rodriguez somehow bats this one home. Panthers up 1-0.
You create those, luck. You create those bounces, those opportunities with hard work and details, and this is what they do, and they get rewarded for it. Evan Rodriguez, it's a big depth goal for them.
1-0 Panthers on top after one. We go to period number two. Boston on a power play. Kevin Stenlund with the steal. Clears that one down the ice. Takes a big hit from Marchand here in the process.
And that's the one thing about Marchand. He got banged up earlier. You know, he's playing wounded somewhat. As we saw later in the game, he didn't return for the third period. But he keeps going. He keeps his team in the game with his physicality.
Chance right there for Trent Frederick. Point blank. Misses just wide.
Yeah, stayed with it. Probably wanted a better look on this just to get enough wood on it. Then tries a little bank off the skate, but Bob holding in firm there.
Here comes Barkov, finds Rodriguez. They've got a 2-on-1. Rodriguez pulls, shoots, and right into the glove.
And Swayman, like he's been all playoffs, he's going to make the big save for you. And again, this is a big point of the game to kind of keep Boston around. Makes a big glove save.
What's that pinch?
By Charlie.
Jeez, Charlie.
This was a massive moment in this game. Mason Lowry called for the high-sticking penalty here on Stephen Lawrence. The Panthers get 4 minutes of power play time off of that.
Just unfortunate. He's been so good for this team, Mason Lowry. Such a smooth puck handling defenseman, and you hate to see it, and this is what happens.
How about that shot from Vladimir Tarasenko? Grip it, rip it, 2-0.
And Florida's power play, which started a little bit slow in the playoffs, is certainly, when they're needed, they step up and make plays. Whether the game's on the line or not, their big guys are there to make plays.
Still on that power play, and how about that play? Tkachuk to Carter Verhaeghe, right on his tape. Panthers lead by 3.
Versus Swaggy, just a little set play, gets to the front of the net, hard on his stick, great pass by Tkachuk, and D-man, you got to get
that stick.
Not what you want to see if you're a Bruins fan. Brad Marchand not returning to this game with that upper body injury. We play on. Jacob Lauko called for the interference penalty here on Bobrovsky. Just taking it strong to the net.
I don't know about that call.
Interesting one. Jimmy got a pretty good chuckle out of that behind the bench there. And as a player, hey, we're not scoring goals. We got to drive them that hard. He does a really good job cutting around the D. Gets bumped into the goalie, but ends up in the box.
So the Panthers go back on the power play, and that puck ends up in the back of the net. Brandon Montour.
Yeah, it looked like a little bit of a skating screen from the forward up front there, and just a little bit of a flutter, but had some juice to it. And Brandon Montour, I mean, they're getting goals from everybody.
All right, Boston needs a goal, and it was the guy that was in the box, Jacob Lauko, comes out and just rips that one. So the Bees get on the board. It's 4-1.
And they hadn't generated anything really offensively. That's their ninth shot to the game, and they're eight minutes into the third period. But they get back in the game with this one.
Lowry to Jake DeBrusk. They're even closer. It's 4-2.
The can of patience from Mason Lowry. Just beautiful sell. Brings Kulikov with him, and just a great finish by Jake DeBrusk. He's been great this playoff. Just unbelievable. Doing everything the Bruins need.
Jake DeBrusk's fifth goal of the playoffs makes it 4-2. Boston on the power play again. 8.5 to go here in the third, and Boston finally getting their fans out of their seats. They were putting some pressure on Bobrovsky. Bob standing tall, though.
You know, that's one thing in this series as well. Boston's power play's really struggled.
Oh, horrible.
That's probably been a difference in the series, is they had chances to be in this game with power plays. This is the first good power play opportunities that they've had, and just didn't go in for them.
Look at that. Boston, clear chance.
Deep. Kick save. Out.
Yeah, Dmitry Kulikov, kick save and a beauty. Old school. We play on. Net empty here. Swayman on the bench. Extra attacker on. Low ride, a coil. Down low. And point blank, DeBrusk can't believe it. Wait till you see the replay off the crossbar.
Just took the 60 degree. Needed a gap wedge. Took the 60 degree wedge. And just a little too much loft on that. But they showed at the end of the game, they can get looks on Florida. They just got to stick to their game and not get frustrated. And they'll get chances. So it's... This should be a game, the last 5-10 minutes, where you say, hey, we can get back in the series.
All right, 4-2. Net still empty here. Extra attacker on. 90 seconds to go. There is Sam Reinhart pushing, chipping ahead, and then into the empty net to make it 5-2 Panthers.
And Reinhart, who's been solid all year, both offensively and defensively. You saw him make a really smart play instead of forcing a play to try to shoot it 100 feet. He tumped it behind the D and was able to get around him and score an easy empty net.
Panthers on the power play again, and why not for good measure? Evan Rodriguez, second goal of this game, 6-2 Florida.
Doesn't matter what time of the game in the playoffs, you know, you're getting ready for next game. You can't give up a goal like this. A little bit lackadaisical by the Bruins. BK, you don't like to see this. Swayman's been so good for this team, kind of leaving him out to dry. So you don't like to see that, guys giving up like that. But, you know, overall, it's just the Panthers are on fire right now and really bounce back after that game one loss.
You can see it right there. Four power play goals in this game. Special team, certainly the difference in game number three. Panthers win it 6-2. They're up 2-1 in the series with game three coming up on Sunday. Let's hear from Brandon Montour after.
Brandon, I suppose it got interesting for a bit there in the third, but otherwise, how are you able to take such control here tonight?
Yeah, I mean, I think obviously pretty full effort. Obviously, we know they're going to push. Obviously, they're personnel. They're going to get their chances, as they did, but the guys stuck with it. No matter what, you know, they score, we kept pushing back, score again. You know, our locker room, our bench didn't get too quiet. We kept the push, kept the pace, and, you know, we got a good locker room in there that, you know, stick with it and, you know, finish that one out.
It's funny how quickly things can change in a series. After game one, it was, what are you going to do about the power play? And you strike four times here tonight, so what was working?
Yeah, you know what? I mean, personally, you know, the bounces haven't been, you know, going in. We're getting a bunch of looks. We're moving the puck well. We're playing with pace. You know, no matter what, you know, we don't score. You know, as long as we get some confidence for our group, get some good movements, get some chances, quality chances. And tonight, you know, obviously, pot a few, and you know, we keep building on that.
Why does your team seem to take such joy playing in hostile environments?
Yeah, I think just our locker room. You know, the guys we have on our team. No matter where it is, we enjoy it. You know, obviously water bottles, towels, rats thrown on the ice there. Guys got a kick of it, but again, we keep pushing forward and we build on the next one.
Lastly, your head coach said that he thinks you're a more serious group this year. I know you love to keep things light, but would you otherwise agree with that?
Yeah, you know what? I think just the experience that this group has had the last, you know, 2 years, especially off last year's, you know, run. We know what it takes, especially at this time of year. Mentally, the ups and downs of a series, the ups and downs of a whole game, and you know, the guys, you know, do such a tremendous job of kind of sticking with it no matter the outcome, and you know, focus on that next one. So we enjoy this one, and like I said, we build on four.
See you Sunday. Yeah, thanks, Brandon.
Yep.
I feel like we talk about it every night in the playoffs. Goaltending, special teams. Look, the special teams different so far in the three games in this round two matchup. 5 power play goals for the Panthers, 0 for the Boston Bruins. So 4 of 6 in this game, 5 for 15 in the series, 0 for 2 in this game, Boston, 0 for 7 so far in this series. Tony, what is making the Florida power play so efficient, so effective at this point?
Well, I think they're gaining confidence, one, in the ability that they can make plays. Second of all, I think the thing that's really important for them, they're playing physical as they always do. You can see the amount of hits in every game. But what's really impressive about the special teams, they've only given Boston 7 power play opportunities in these first 3 games. So they're playing physical, but they're playing discipline. I think that's a big factor in this series, because when Florida gets themselves in trouble, they're killing 4 or 5 penalties a game. You stay to 1 or 2 every game, your penalty killers will do the job, and then you give your power play guys a chance like they did tonight. I mean, 4 power play goals in the game. Boston, you know, for the most part, they're in that game. It's 1-0. They weren't generating anything offensively, but they were hanging in the game. And then Lurie's penalty that gave them a double minor. They get 2 power play goals on it, and really the game's over.
And they're being very intentional and with the way they're running their power play. They're shooting when they have a chance to shoot. The bomb's away, and they scored 3 different ways. 1 off the flank, 1 from the top, and then 1 net front. So they're given different looks. And that's kind of a credit to that power play all year. They're able to kind of, everybody can filter in and out of certain positions, and they're not a one-trick pony. If Sam Reinhart's not open and can't get it, if they can't get it to him, they're going to get it to somebody else who's going to score. And it's just been a credit to this team. There's somebody that does it every single game, and they're a scary team when everybody's contributing, which they have been all year.
And Montour said something in that interview. He goes, we've been through this before.
Yeah.
We know what it takes.
Confidence.
And you can see that group on the bench. If things aren't going well, they cellar down. They keep each other in the game. And there's not long stretches of the game where the other team dominates. They had that first game against Boston where they might have had a little bit of too much rest in between.
Sleepy,
a little bit sleepy, kind of feeling their way in the series. And once they realize, hey, guys, let's get her going again. Then game 2, they started to take over, and it carried over to this game.
There's long stretches in these games when you're watching the Bruins thinking these guys can't get a shot on net. The shots ended up being 33-16 in favor of the Panthers. If you're the Bruins, what are the Panthers doing so well to limit that shot suppression at this point?
Well, they're just not, you know, they're not getting on the forecheck like they normally do, and they're getting out of their game. They're allowing Florida to kind of disturb them a little bit and frustrate them. So, and Bruins are typically the team that frustrates you with their structure. So when you see this going on, this is a little bit concerning. But for them, it just needs to be, you saw the last 10 minutes of the game, get pucks to the net, bodies to the net. That's the way they create offense. It's not really just the prettiest at times, but they just wave after wave of structure and getting bodies and pucks to the net. And they just haven't been able to get that against Florida. And that's what Florida does. They kind of just disturb you, take you out of your game. You start playing their game, and they do their game way better than
they can frustrate you fast.
It's a little concerning to see this from Boston, but they just need to get back to that last 10 minutes of that game. You know, you throw out the empty net goal, but and that PK goal where I thought they quit, but it's that goal by Lauko and that goal by DeBrus was Bruins hockey, and they got to just find that, bottle that up.
Overthink.
Yeah, it's only 2-1 in the series.
Yeah,
we all forget. We feel like the series is over, but
the way they're playing.
Does it feel like it just only because of the results of the last 2 games? It has been Florida right from the get-go.
Yeah.
It just feels like the Bruins haven't even had a chance in these 2 games.
That's what it kind of feels like. And people, you could see it a little bit in the body language during the game. They're running out of position, trying to kill guys. And you just can't do that with Florida because they're just going to stay in their structure. They're unflappable. And it's just not Boston's game. They're a calm, cool, collected group.
Agreed. And I think that the one thing that they could build a little bit on is that 10 minutes to start the third period when they did get their 2 goals. Yeah. Marchand's out of the lineup. He's hurt. He's in the locker room with an ice bag on somewhere. And they found a way to get back in the game. And they had their push. They had those power play chances that we saw that they could have made it 4-3. And
Russ scores there. It's a 1-goal game.
Another comeback in the playoffs here with a 4-goal deficit. We've seen a couple of them already. And he kind of felt like that was coming. So maybe they did build a little bit of confidence in that third period. But I think Jimmy Montgomery has been really good at righting the ship when anything's gone a little bit wrong in Boston. Swayman's a big answer in the net. They probably go back with him, I would say. It's still
have to. It wasn't. There's nothing. They need run support for him.
They kept
him in as long as.
And he's a guy that can win games for him like he did in the Toronto series.
It's still a game.
So there's another reason that they should feel optimistic that they get back in the series.
A reason maybe to not feel optimistic is the name you mentioned, Brad Marchand. We see him kind of get tangled up with Sam Bennett there in the first. He played and then didn't return for period number 3. Missed the rest of the game, upper body injury. We don't know the extent. If there's a chance he plays, he's going to play. But if this guy can't play, is that something that this Boston team can overcome, playing the Florida Panthers at this point without their captain?
In the playoffs, you have to. You don't have a choice. And he's the heartbeat of their team. And, you know, Pasta's proven that he can lead this team. So, but it's next man up.
In playoffs, you look at the Toronto series and Matthews goes down. They're down 3-1. You say series over, no Matthews, 70 goals. How are they going to replace that? Mm. They buckled down. They found a way to win two games and actually have a really good chance to win game seven as well. So same situation there. Someone's got to come up in the locker room and say, it doesn't matter who's in our lineup. We know how we play. We know what we have to do to be successful. We have been consistent throughout the year. We just need our A game tonight, and we can get back in the series.
And he said it, that the 10 minutes when they made that push, bottle that up.
Yeah.
Show clips of that and be like, this is how we can get to them. Got to keep going with that. They're capable of doing it, so it's just going to be on them in that room.
Speaking of a guy that's been out, we saw Sam Bennett miss the last five games, comes back with that hand injury, playing with something. But how did he have an impact in this game three?
Oh, I mean, physical. He can make plays. He's just one of those
hard to play against.
Yeah, one of those rare. I almost consider him a power forward a little bit, just the way he can take pucks to the net. But he also has that skill to him. And he frustrated that Bruins team and just, you know, got it on the offense. And he's just a great player for them.
And you get Barkov as one, him as two. That's two big centers right down the middle. That's pretty tough to, no matter who you are, to play against those two guys shift after shift. They're going to wear you down.
Sam Bennett back in the lineup after missing the last five games. Instant impact. His team wins 6-2. Let's go back to Boston and hear what Bennett had to say.
I love playoff hockey. It's a little faster. It's more physical. It's every play is a little bit more important. You're able to go out there and lay it all on the line because of how important the game is. I love that opportunity.
We don't like losing, especially at home. And I think what we're looking forward to now is an opportunity to even the series. A win's a win and a loss a loss in playoffs, no matter what the score is, how it's done. And we're really lucky and fortunate to have another chance to even the series next game.
I don't think we're on top of our game. Our execution, to be honest, the last two games, or last two periods of last game and the first two periods of tonight has just not been good enough. You know, and that's why I say that's my fault. I got to be better. It's not good enough. That's all I know. No, Florida was good. We weren't. Move on to the next game.
Up next, it's off to Vancouver for game two between the Oilers and Canucks. Would this one play out like the craziness we saw in game number one? Find out next. Game two between the Oilers and Canucks. The Oilers looking to tie the series up at one game apiece. Yep, you leave the house thinking, this is the outfit tonight.
Yep. My wife set a bar, and I'm here looking at highlights. Let's go, baby.
Here we go. You saw Connor McDavid held shotless in game one. First time he's not had a shot on goal in the playoffs in his career. Early in this game, you've got a tripping on Nikita Zadorov. So 20 seconds into the power play, JT Miller to Elias Pettersson, 1-0 Vancouver.
Adam Henrique first came back. A little bit of a miscue through the middle. You got to have your stick in the lane, but great play by JT Miller to Elias Pettersson, who... Don't let this guy get hot.
No, and Miller's fake shot froze the goalie there for a
froze
second.
Froze him. Yeah.
No chance at it.
Tyler Myers hooking on Zach Hyman there. 30 seconds to go in the power play. Yep. Not going to slow those guys down. Give a go, McDavid and Draisaitl.
You said it right. You're not going to slow those guys down, but I don't think you can sit back and let them skate around and not pressure.
No.
They sat back, and obviously they made a quick little play. Draisaitl catches it in the four. Shelovs can get to a position right in the back of the net.
Well, there goes McDavid again down the ice. His first shot on goal in the series. Artur Shelovs with the stop. Seconds winding down here in the first. Oilers with a chance. Shelovs the save. Zach Hyman with a chance, and he misses on the rebound.
I mean, this line or this group of five was incredible all night. Played heavy minutes. So many chances. Shelovs is up to the task there.
Period number two. Carson Soucy shoots. Brock Besser with the tip. Canucks take the lead.
Yeah, and a little bit of miscoverage on a faceoff loss, 4-on-4. You can see two defenders trying to scramble back to get to the net. There's a high tip by Besser. Soucy gets the puck through. A little high tip. You can see front of the net. A little Miller was by himself there, so a little bit of bad coverage on Edmonton off the faceoff.
That lead didn't last very long. 20 seconds later, Draisaitl to Matthias Ekholm. We're tied again.
Turnover, a little mishap, but JT Miller goes to the wrong spot, tries to do Brock Besser's job. That would have landed right on his stick. Just a little bit of miscommunication again on the 4-on-4, so gives it right back.
Isos game up at 2, 7.5 to go in the period. Sam Lafferty with a chance here. Stuart Skinner up to the challenge.
Toe save and a beauty.
Over 5 minutes left in the second. Hugh Suter called for Puck over glass here.
That's
Scrum and Soos, yeah.
Barry.
Susie and Dreisaitl roughing penalties as well. So all kinds of things happening on this sequence.
Penalty and a concussion. The old two for one.
Well, nothing comes out of those penalties, but shortly after, McDavid hitting Quinn Hughes here in the face. Hughes bleeding, but no high stick called on that one.
It is interesting because it looked like Kelly Sutherland had a good view of it, but said he didn't see it. Hughes gets a little cut up, but back in action.
Speaking of cutting up, how about Zadorov cutting up the twine from a distance and the tough angle?
You're not asleep. What a segue. Got to pressure Zadorov. Can't let him sit here. Obviously, the RVH is going to be a big topic of conversation. Got to get that out of the game for goalies, but got to pressure him if you're a D-man. Don't let Zadorov shoot.
All right, third period we go. Oilers on the power play. McDavid, ping, off the post. Hyman not in the right place at the right time to hammer home the rebound.
Yeah, and the thing that makes Edmonton's power play so good, you saw McDavid there on his forehand side coming down for a shot. You saw him earlier at the goal line. You see him at the top. You see him all over the place. So for a defending team, it's really hard to know where he is.
Yeah, well, there he is. And there he goes, 97, yeah, doing what he does. And we're tied again, 3-3.
Two bad pinches at the early in the third period. You hate to see it. Give Edmonton, give Connor a chance to get on this puck. And Shelob's just back in his net. Just, you know, when you got big Connor McJesus coming down.
He was flying today. He was on a mission at the start of this game that they were going to win this game.
She don't loves that. That's for sure. The Oilers, a couple of chances here. JT Miller. And Shelob's presenting that goal, or preventing that goal, I should say. Coming up huge.
And what a block at the end here, too. Just a mad scramble in front. Playoff hockey, five guys deep. JT Miller making a big block when it's needed. It's the playoffs, baby.
Two and a half to go. Hyman to Ekholm across the crease, and that one broken up. And guess what? We're going overtime.
So nice. Why don't you touch the hiney? The Zach Hyman.
All right, to OT we go in overtime. Here he comes, 97, winding this one up. Drops it off to Dreisaitl. Dreisaitl for a Bush bomb. Not quite, but still effective. 4-3 in overtime. Edmonton gets it done.
Just Dreisaitl doing what he does best with Connor, just pushing the defenders back. A little bit of an over back check. Great pump fake by Bouchard. And then a little bit of luck. You create this. You could feel this coming. You could feel this coming all game. They're putting so many pucks to the net and bodies to the net. And just a, you know, unfortunate bounce by Ian Poulter, who's played great this series.
The other thing that you saw in that rush, McDavid picks the puck up behind his goal line. He's all of a sudden, Vancouver retreats, which they did so well in game one. They didn't retreat. They got a way to angle him and keep him to the outside and not let him gain the zone. There they let him gain the zone. He pulls up deep in the zone and he finds Bouchard coming in late.
The big boys with a big night. Dreisaitl, McDavid, 4 points apiece. The Oilers tie this series up at one game apiece. Let's hear from Evan Bouchard after.
All right, Evan, before we have a look at the goal, you get the split. I'll just leave it to you to describe the magnitude of that victory.
Yeah, that was huge. You know, we came out hard, played hard all game long, got rewarded for it in overtime.
Okay, the goal. It wasn't exactly a 97-mile-per-hour Bush bomb. What were you trying to do here?
You know, the goalie played good. I honestly tried just throwing it to the net, and, you know, maybe Hyman tips it, but luckily for me, it was their guy who tipped it.
All right, thank you, Evan. Appreciate your time. Congratulations on the win.
Thank you.
Evan Bouchard with the overtime game winner. You can see what he's done his last five playoff games. He's got 7 points, 2 goals, 5 helpers, 3 of those coming by way of that oh-so-potent power play, and 2 coming by way of game-winning goals. So get it done in the most key and clutch moments. Like we said, you heard Scott Oak there. It's not the Bouch bomb that we're accustomed to seeing, the grip and rip it, but still just as effective in this scenario.
I mean, you look back to last year when they kind of gave the keys to the kingdom to him and let him go. I mean, it's just incredible. Ice in his veins. He's so calm under pressure. What sometimes frustrates people with him is that he has zero heartbeat out there, but it's what makes him so good to be able, in that moment, not just hammer the puck, but make a nice little pump fake, change the angle. And listen, it's a lucky bounce, but Hyman's right behind there. So if that misses Cole's stick, Hyman's probably depositing that in the back then.
Yeah, and the other thing I like, and you saw in the statistics there in the last five games, the plus six thing stood out to me because he's known as an offensive defenseman. There's always people that say, well, he's a liability defensively. He's going to hurt you in the playoffs. It'd be plus six in the last five games important. So I think Paul Coffey going there, being an offensive defenseman, maybe one of the best two ever to play with him and Bobby Orr. Maybe a couple others you could put in that same sentence. But Coff has taught him to be responsible without the puck. He said, we'll turn you loose offensively, but when you don't have the puck, we need you to help keep it out of our net. Mm. So I think he's been a big impact on his development, his career, and his season.
Yeah. And 97 always has a big impact on this Oilers team, right? No
Shocker.
Shots in game number one, comes back with a massive impact in game two, 4 points. How did he look from your perspective?
He had the puck a lot, and he played a lot. I think this is one of the games that probably talked with the coaching staff about game one. He said, hey, you know, this is what I felt, but if I get a little bit more flow and be in the game a little bit more and get that ice time, I'll get in the game and we'll win. And when you got a great player like that, you got somebody that can take your team on his back, and in as big of a game as this is, they couldn't go back to Edmonton down 2-0. They needed this win, and 97 was there to make sure that that happened.
You want to win? Put 97 in. Let him spin, coach.
Hard to defend tonight, it's, no matter what you do.
It's so hard because you always end up, you want to go with depth on this team and let's roll four lines, but you always end up, it's so easy to go back to that Hyman, Drysdale, McDavid together and just roll with them. And it's just incredible what they can do. It's security, but they can man the load, and they can handle that ice time. And they're so dynamic. They're so incredible. They play so well off each other, and they're, for such a big game on a huge stage, to play the way they played today, they were playing downhill all night, attacking the net. And this is a kind of game they're like, when he decides, like, we're winning this game, I want this game. I mean, he's such a factor at a high level, him and Draisaitl.
Yeah, the other thing that I can picture on the bench, and I'm the coach, I'm Knobloch, I'm on the bench. I think every time that he was sitting on the bench, he was standing up ready to go. And then when you're a coach and you see your best guy ready to go, you're like, okay.
Yeah.
Go ahead. I played with Gretzky. When Gretz needed to be on the ice, you put him on the ice. Coach Forsberg, Sakic.
Yeah.
When they wanted to go, they'd turn around or they'd stand up and be ready to go. Other players like Sid, for sure, same thing. Those great, used to do that. Did it work? Because when I stood up, they said, sit back down.
They're like the stools over there in the corner.
Sit down.
All right, but those guys would obviously like to play 60 minutes time on ice in every regulation game. That's probably not great time management. McDavid, 24 minutes, 3 seconds time on ice in this game. Looking big picture, and you brought up a great point. During that lengthy winning streak during the regular season, his minutes were managed a little bit better. He was down about 18 and stuff. Yeah, this one went to overtime. But big picture, if they want to win the cup, if you're Coach Knobloch, do you have to get those minutes down just a little bit and maybe get some more from other guys up and down that roster?
100%. I don't think you can do this. You know, six guys, bare, like under 10 minutes. You have Henrik at 11. But you could argue that this is six guys, 10 minutes or less. And you can't do this and sustain this over a whole playoff. I know Connor wants to and can play 26 a night, but you need to be back there as a coach and be managing, being like, I need to get guys in the game, need to get them feeling confident. Obviously, this was a game they needed, but you're going back home to Edmonton. This should be a four-line night, game three. They should be rolling the lines. Let everybody feel the puck, because what happens is when they do get tired, now you got to roll out a guy who's played, hasn't played in 10 minutes, and how does that feel on the bench? You're a forward.
It's tough. It's tough to jump in a game when you're not playing regularly. Yeah. You're sitting on the bench because you feel like the coach doesn't have confidence in you. Then you say, okay, go out there in overtime and play. And
how do you manage that as a coach?
Well,
big picture versus, hey, we got to win tonight.
Well, I mean, again, they won the game, so the coach did the right thing tonight. But as they move forward, if they're going to win, 4, 8, 12, 11 more games, they're going to have to get some production out of the third and fourth line, those guys that played under 10 minutes tonight. And to do that, you got to play them. And you got to show confidence in them that you can play them. Yep. And I think that's the most important thing.
How about confidence in the goaltending? I mean, Shelob's doing what he's done so far in this playoffs as the third goaltender in that depth chart. But what about the other end, Stuart Skinner? Didn't face a whole lot of shots in this game. Sometimes that's a harder scenario, but how do you think you felt about him confidence-wise?
I'm still a little worried. I mean, both goalies were shaky at times, you know, obviously, but Skinner's the number one. You don't have anything, you don't have a security blanket back there. You know, Shelob's is number three. You have DeSmith and you have Demko that, you know, might be back this series, but Skinner's their guy. So he has to exude confidence back there. And a couple of the mishaps last game, and then tonight, this RVH thing, I know it's a big topic of conversation, but he just felt like he was a little nervous. There's the short side. He was felt like he was searching for the puck a little bit too much. And, you know, listen, he made some good saves in this game. But if I'm Vancouver, I'm trying to test him way more than they tested him tonight. Because and you give credit to Edmonton's defense and the way they were creating offensive zone chances. So it was less time in their D zone. But he's got to start exuding more confidence if they want to go on a deep run.
Yeah, I'm going to go to the other end. I'm going to say for Vancouver to win, you know, I like the way Shelov's played. Mm-hmm. He's done a good job on getting them where they're at. But I think one of the other two guys has to come in soon if they're going to beat Edmonton. So I don't know if Demko will be ready by this time.
The initial reports prior to this series was that Demko probably out the first four games of this series. But after that, TBD.
If DeSmith is healthy, do you go to him in game three?
I do.
Yeah, young kid going into Edmonton.
Yeah,
I mean, not to say that DeSmith is an old dog, but him going into Edmonton, I'd be more comfortable than Shelov.
If he's ready to play.
Yeah, because a young kid going in, that's a daunting task.
Has this series played out in the first two games how you thought it might going into this one?
Yeah, you could argue that Edmonton could be up 2-0. You know, they went to sleep.
Should be up 2-0, right?
Should, you know, you can't play should or would. It plays out the way it's going to play out, but they were firmly in control in game one, and they just took their foot off the gas. And tonight they had and it seemed like Vancouver, every time they got up, they took a breath, Edmonton would recover, and they made some mental errors that they didn't make in game one. So now it's like game three is a huge, massive game for Edmonton going back home with all the momentum.
Yeah, and you know, Vancouver, for me, again, you got your third goalie in there. They did some really good things to stay in this game. They had a chance. They had a chance to win it. They were up 3-2 going into the third.
Yeah.
They did a great job in game one of staying out of the box completely. They only gave them one power play. Tonight, you give them a couple more, and guess what happens? Yeah. David gets going. He touches the puck more, and they score.
Yeah. Both teams 1-for-3 on the power play. Edmonton gets it done 4-3 in overtime. McDavid, ho-hum, just a little 4.9 in the playoffs. Let's go back to Vancouver and hear from number 97.
I didn't think I worked at the level that I can in game one, and you got to make it hard on them. You know, you want to make them skate up and down the rink with you, and I know that when I work, there's not many that can play with me, and you know, I thought our whole team was good. I thought our little five-man group there with Leo, High, and Ek, and Bush were real good tonight, and found a way to get a win here.
Thought this game was a game where we took over the game halfway through it, and we just kept coming, kept pushing. The fact that we didn't score a goal late in the third was crazy to me. I thought we had chances on chance on chance. So good on us sticking with it in OT, finally get one. You know, in OT, it's a bounce. It's whatever. You saw this goal, too. It's a bounce, and it goes in, right? But I thought we earned it throughout the night. I thought, as you're saying, they had a hell of a comeback in the first game. I thought tonight we had that comeback.
All the problem is we just didn't play well in the offensive zone. Like, we made it very easy on them. I talk all the time about our best defense is playing forward, winning, you know, sustaining ozone time, and we didn't do that one time today, so that's on us. And if we're not going to spend time in the ozone, I mean, you're good luck at that point, right, against them.
And some guys here, they got to pick it up too. I mean, they want to play, but you got to dig in. Like, you can't be a liability. I mean, you know, if you're not getting much ice time, there's a reason why, and we need some guys to pick it up a little bit.
Up next, after making a change behind the bench, it sounds like the Leafs might have some more shuffling coming up this summer. We've got more details on that next. Welcome back. You're watching NHL Tonight. The Toronto Maple Leafs failing to get past round one yet again. You can see in the last 5 years under Sheldon Keefe, getting past round one just once. That was last year. Moving on to round two, but losing eventually in that one. Here's Leafs general manager Brad Treliving on the changes already made in Toronto.
I don't question that we had a real good coach here. Sometimes, unfortunately, in this business, over a period of time, the message, I don't want to say they stop listening, but the message stops hitting home. And that's not just a coach issue. That's, we've said here, player personnel, we've got to look at those things. Everything, you know, it's not just changing the personnel, but understanding why a message may not be getting through. So our focus right now is trying to find that individual. There's not just one magic point here. I do think one of the things as I look at our team and as we as we evaluate it over the course of the coming weeks, is we've got to find a way to do the hard, unsexy things longer, and those things don't require skill. Right? There's some things in these in this sport and in our games, especially this time of year, that are not related to skill, but they help you win.
Brendan Shanahan is the president of the Toronto Maple Leafs. He's a champion. He's a three-time Stanley Cup winner. What I saw in my 4 weeks with the two gentlemen beside me showed me that the chemistry and unity is being built at the highest levels.
But there's a time where you look at the age and the development of players and you talk about patience. And then there comes a time where you see certain patterns and trends repeat themselves, results repeat themselves. And that's what we have to do this summer. Without getting specific, I've said earlier, it's not our intention here today to single any one individual out or any one small group of this team out. We're talking about the whole team. What we are saying is that it has certainly become evident that we have to assess all of those things and assess whether or not we have to make some very difficult decisions this summer to make the team better.
All right, so a lot of assessment coming up in the coming weeks, months. Hey, got to assess a lot, and there's a lot of assessment going on when it comes to these contracts, right? A lot of scrutiny. Four players locked up with $40 million. That's a large slice of the pie. You can see the core four, what they make, and what their contracts run through. You heard from the general manager kind of talking about, look, they had the right coach in place. Yeah. There was a lot of beating
around the bush. Eh?
Well, yeah, but now if you want to get down to the nitty-gritty, what happens in Toronto? What has to happen next? Because he said the message wasn't getting through. The message was okay, it just wasn't getting through. They changed the coach. Now what happens?
Well, I think the changes aren't done. And, you know, he went a roundabout way about not answering the question, but alluding to the fact that they don't really believe in the core four anymore. I don't see it moving forward. You have to make a change. Something big needs to happen. And, you know, you can't move Nylander or Amat, so I think it's obviously the two guys that are potential odd man out, or Tavares or Marner, but I think Tavares, I don't know if anybody's going to take him at that cap hit. I don't think he'll move his no-move clause, so I think Marner's the odd man out. So how do you have the conversation with him to be like, listen, it's not going to work out. We're going to move on from you. Let's make this amicable and find a way to put you in a good spot and get something good in return.
But what do they want in return? What do they need? If they're losing a player like Marner. Okay.
Yeah, D and a goalie. They need a D and a... And
because first it felt thing, like in the playoffs, it wasn't about... The defense was okay and the goaltending was okay. Just the offense wasn't enough. They couldn't score enough goals, right?
It's the D that they brought in. So McCabe, I thought, did well. And I also thought Edmondson did well. And Benoit's done a good job. I think they still need another D-man to shore it up back there. They need a solid top four, and then obviously they need to solidify goaltending. They need goaltending to be something that is a bedrock of this team moving forward.
Yeah, I think the coach is the first thing. Get the coach in there. Let him help on the assessment of what he has seen from the outside. Let him do some self-evaluation as far as figuring out what he wants in that locker room. And then go from there. But I agree with you on those contracts there and those big four players, the two that you mentioned, and Tavares and Marner, probably one of those guys will be the one that is maybe moved out to try to add a piece, like you said. I don't know about the goalie yet, because Wall might be a goalie. He might,
yeah,
you know. So
yeah.
I don't
but
know.
Maybe somebody to come back him up. They had a lot of injuries too in goaltending. Anyway, who's your coach that you like?
Well, everyone's saying Berube.
Yeah,
I would love to see Joel Quenneville back behind him. So,
I'd like you too.
I do. I would. Because the way he handled Chicago, he had young superstars when he got there with Kane and Taze and Seabrook and Keith. Let's not kid ourselves. Matthews is a superstar.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
A lot of people are disappointed in the playoffs because he missed those two games. Still scored 70 goals. Still was in discussion as a Selke type of player. That's a pretty good hockey player that you're building a team around.
He's awesome.
So you got that piece, and then maybe Joel is the guy that potentially could help mold those skilled players, turn them into what he helped with Kane and Taze and those guys become.
Yeah. Marner, no move clause. How do you move him if he doesn't want to move?
cut the power to his house.
You got a lot of good ideas.
Cut the brakes.
Okay. I've never seen that tactic used quite yet.
Yeah, inside of my
make it real. Seen it. We've heard it.
Yeah. Make it real uncomfortable for him around the rink. You know, make sure no one.
I don't know that necessarily they got to do that. I don't.
I think
something has to happen.
I think someone in that core four. It's been. You could blame Keith and the coaching staff, but you know, you said it. Once you get a coach in, they need to address that. Just because they need to do something.
Can I bring up one point?
Yes.
Matthews was hurt for two of the big games.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And who else? Nylander missed the first three.
Yeah.
Okay. They almost won that series.
Yep.
And when everybody counted them out when they were down 3-1, they gutted it out. They won two big games. They dominated lots of those two games. Almost won game seven, played really good, okay?
Yeah,
so they're not that far away, even though it looked like it. And I know you're saying Florida's manhandling right now.
No,
a little bit.
I was just going to say, to your point, game seven, all four of them were there and they lost.
Okay, but they could have won that game easily.
Yeah.
Swayman was a big difference in that.
Huge. So one of them's missing, they play well.
So there's your thing. So you just take one out and
take
they play
one
better?
Out.
Okay.
That's it.
We learned it in game five and six what needs to be done.
That's every single time.
They could rotate next year. If two guys play, one guy rests every game, and then boom, they'll win 16.
The only thing I took away from that is that if my tires are slashed or on blocks tonight, I know who I'm looking at coming at
you. The power.
Sleazy guy. Unbelievable. In the night. When we come back here on NHL Tonight, we're heading overseas. We're going to check in on the World Championships. USA taking on Sweden. We've got those highlights after this. Welcome back to NHL Tonight. We've got your highlights from Team USA's first game at the World Championships, taking on Sweden.
There's Heed, Eriksson Ek, waiting, shooting, score! Joel Eriksson Ek with a wrister, and Sweden opens up their campaign at the tournament 1-0.
I think the U.S. led up a little bit. They were getting a penalty, and I think it was going to be a hooking call on Zegras. I think that was a stoppable puck. He just didn't seem to pick it up early.
Good chance for him in front. Sweden pressing. Lucas Raymond and shoots, score! What a snipe! Lucas Raymond, 2-0 Sweden.
Sweden's moving inside the offensive zone again, and the U.S. gets split apart a little bit, but they're giving up the high areas in the middle of the ice.
It's up top, Jones drops it back, Werenski, Bob score! Zach Werenski with the bullet, and there's your response, 2-1 hockey game.
What a pass by Seth Jones. This looks like they haven't missed a beat. This is from a couple of years ago. They don't play together anymore. Seth Jones is in Chicago, but for 4 years, Werenski and Jones played together almost exclusively. And that is a goal scorer's goal.
Stretches the ice a little bit. Pass across, shot, score! The wrist shot, Marcus Johansson. And Sweden leads by two again.
And Lyons, who is aggressive, he's out on the edge of the paint, but he can't quite get over on the short side, and that's a terrific shot.
And away goes Alex Lyon to the bench. Extra attacker out. Trying to center up top. Victor Hedman bobs it in from the blue line. Hedman delivers a rocket, and it's 4-2 Sweden. Sweden opens up the tournament with the win.
Team USA looking to bounce back as they'll take on Germany coming up on Saturday at 2 p.m. You can watch that game live right here on the NHL Network. Coming up next, we look ahead to Saturday and two more games on tap. The Rangers trying to sweep their series in Carolina, and the Stars coming off a winning game two, heading to Colorado for game three. Welcome back. Looking ahead to Saturday's slate. Two more games on tap. The Rangers trying to close out their series on the road down in Raleigh in game number four. Stars and Avs. That one tied up at one as that series now shifts to Colorado for game number three. We'll start with the early one down at PNC Arena. A lot of people think this one might be done in four. You said not so fast. You think it's going back to MSG.
Why? Well, first of all, I think Carolina's played better than being down 0-3.
Yep.
I mean, we're all talking about they got to create more traffic in front of the net. They got to crash and bang a little bit more to score more ugly goals, whatever it is. They still played really good hockey. The difference for me, special teams, lots of the series. If they get a little bit of momentum going offensively, I think on the power play offensively, I think they can get back.
How do they do that? How do they generate something on the man advantage here? Why are you chuckling?
Watch Florida's power play.
Or Edmonton.
And just take that. And
do they have the weapons to do that?
Yes.
Power play, everybody does?
It's crazy because 5-on-5, they're generating chances. There's movement. They're getting pucks and bodies. And that all of a sudden you get to their power play and it's stagnant. They have nobody net front and there's no... They're not being, like I said before, they're not being intentional. They're not shooting and getting to the net. So it's like all of a sudden they forget their identity, which, you know, their power play was great all year, too.
And when the power play struggles, what do? You stop and you think. When you're going well, you just go and you flow you move. So I think that's part of it. I think that Rindy's got to just find a way to get those guys confident. Hey, guys, you've been great all year. Tonight, the power play is going to be different in the game. This is what we're going to do. We're going to create more motion. We're going to create more motion, put a little bit more pressure on Trocheck and Kreider and whoever's killing penalties on the Rangers side to have to recognize and be able to react to different setups that we're showing. But if you stand still, it's easy to kill.
Yep.
So I think they got to put some more pressure on the penalty.
All right. How about the late one tomorrow night? Out west in Colorado, tied at 1. Two slow starts in games 1 and 2 for the Avs. They come all the way back in game 1. Come back, not quite enough in game number 2. What are you looking for in game 3?
I mean, what a series, right? I think Georgiev is going to have a bounce back, but I mean, I think it's just going to be this back and forth series, and it's going to be who can assert themselves early and then hold that lead as long as you can, just because, I mean, when Colorado's going, they're so dominant, but I love how finally you saw with Jamie Benn, he did it in the first series against Vegas with that hit on Brady McNabb, and he set the tone on Devon Taves. You got to hit those guys. You got to make them uncomfortable, because if you let them get going and let them get confident, I mean, it's going to be a long night. So I thought it was great, and they started investing in the body.
The thing I like, first of all, Dallas is extremely well coached. Mm-hmm. They were down 2-0 against Vegas going into Vegas. Mm-hmm. They played 2 great road games. They have all year. They've been one of the best teams on the road all year.
Yeah.
Colorado is one of the best home teams, for sure, the best.
Yeah,
so you go into this game, and you're thinking, wow, this is a great matchup. So we're knotted up. And I think it's going to come down to goaltending. And what's the other thing?
Special
teams. There you
teams.
Go. There you go. But in physicality, because Ben has had an impact in a positive way.
Yeah.
You got to play those guys physical.
Yeah.
You got to stay out of the box on the one side of it. And then when you do get your power play opportunities, you got to find a way to capitalize.
This is 7 games written all over it, too.
Oh, I hope so. Every night's been so good. Every single night of playoff hockey has been great. We hope the same coming up with 2 more on Saturday. Keep it locked right here. NHL Tonight rolls on after this.